A very good morning to all of you. Cities are known for their warmth. More than the buildings or structures, if you go to a city, you are attracted by the warmth. I came to Hyderabad first time as a intermediate student in 1978, and I fell in love with the city. I have moved as part of my work to many cities, but somehow Hyderabad holds a charm and attraction as a person to me, not only to me, but several persons throughout the country, which shows that there is something to the city which attracts people. In fact, many of our income tax chief commissioners, when they retire, they don't go back to Bengal, they don't go back to UP, they don't go back to their native place like Tamil Nadu, but they settle in Hyderabad. The same way, many army people, they settle in Pune. That city holds attraction for them. But to give the warmth, it is the planning, it is the structures, it is the care that is taken by organizations like GHMC, HMDA, or we have got a metro also now. So basically, when people are comfortable, they're warm. If people are not comfortable, they will fight among themselves. Most of the problems India facing today are because the leg space or the shoulder space is not available. That's why we are fighting. So the primary duty of any city through its administration or planners or anyone else who is interested, like you and me, we have gathered here because we all feel the Hyderabad should be a better Hyderabad. So I'll thank the organizers for holding such a conclave and taking a topic like this, and also inviting me as a chairperson. Though my knowledge, I think I will add only the human element to the entire discussion. Not that others are inhuman, but if you want to make a city livable, warm, and hospitable, it is the underlying systems like structures or the sewerage systems, water systems, the beautiful lakes which make Hyderabad, or the beautiful rocky landscape which is not available at many places. And the primary responsibility lies with the people whom are, they are the, I'll say, captains of the trade, where the speakers today are they're very seniors and experts in this area, and some of them are presently in charge of the development of the city also. Data is the king. And though I am not a town planner, my daughter is a town planner and architect. So we were discussing, she works on gender sensitive transportation. She has presented some papers also somewhere. So when you develop, again we go back to the concept of ease and warmth. So we were sitting and one day discussing how to develop an app where a woman can know, coming from a different place, how she can know which place is safe. So how do you know whether there is any convenience nearby, whether there is any restaurant nearby or public convenience nearby where women can go? So you go to a place, how comfortable you feel for a woman in the gender sensitive planning. So unless you have the data, or when we go to New York, I went to New York and Washington, they say don't go to that 32 Avenue in the evening time, because if it is, nobody is there, the chances of you are getting mugged is very high. In fact, some of my scientist friends, when they went, one person went two times, he got mugged up. So that means you should be able to identify hotspots, sensitive zones, and desensitize them in the sense of making it comfortable. So data is the king, and all the four areas you have mentioned are very, very, very important. And I think I'm thankful to the three experts on the panel. for giving excellent presentations, especially for uninitiated people like me who would be interested in knowing. Only thing is, I'll close with there are various kinds of developments possible, because I am also, though I don't work in that area, but I'm very keen observer of how the cities grow and all, because sometimes taxation is also involves people's welfare, because you grow, I collect tax. So what, when we visited New York and all, it is the vision of the city planners that they've got something called Central Park. In fact, it took me 2 days, 3 days to walk around the park. And if you see, the development is around that Central Park. They got a Long Island and all, that's a different story. But that means whenever you come out, you have a pleasant picture. That is New York. So Hyderabad also have our own KBR Park. And Bangalore, despite all its problems, is known for its parks. And I lived sometime in Chennai, and I never knew that Chennai has a beautiful tree cover, which is unfortunately slowly fading away in Hyderabad. So we have to bring back those elements into picture. And I hope with the people around here, and I think there is another session also where you will have much interesting discussion with the commission, the GHMs and all. One is reclaiming the road is depending upon the citizens. Neither GHMC nor town planner. Suppose somebody by force puts a tent on the road and claims it is a more as a law and order matter rather than, so it is our duty. I went to Mysore long back. People are very orderly there. Same thing is not to be said about Kanpur or Hyderabad. So that is number one. And you said actually, we are talking of hydrogen fuel cells and cars which will be almost zero pollution or zero discharge. Even the discharge would be water. But as of today, I don't think even in the entire world anybody can predict, let alone Hyderabad. Hyderabad is a very small destination compared to the world. And predicting that what would be the nature of a future car, because autopilot car or pilotless car, that is not the issue. In our transportation sense, the capacity, speed, the ease of moving, maybe you can have a drone. And the kind of fuel it will use. So I think it would be very premature in the Indian context to predict. Hopefully, I think your suggestions are well taken. Probably it will evolve on its own. Sometimes God finds the solution rather than the man. So we hope that we will be in a better place with cars without any discharge, pollution, and everybody going freely. And since the days of Albert Toffler, who in his power, this third wave and power shift, he said that people will start working from office. I'm yet to see that for the last 25 years. Because definitely working from home will be always a limited component, because man is a social animal. All our town planning is based on our impulse, but people should come together, because if we had such kind of facility, we could have sat at our homes and this conference would have been beamed at homes. But the kind of feeling when we come and meet and work together, I think that cannot be replaced in the near future. Therefore, working from home is only more, as in my opinion, a fashionable concept, and it may take a lot of time to realize it. Now, Ganesh Nimajjanam was a very old concept, and Samuhika Nimajjanam came during freedom struggle. There was a purpose for it. You have to understand the history before talking that everything is wrong. We have to understand the history. Now, at a particular time, it was necessary in Hyderabad to go as a collective body of people and do Nimajjanam. Now, when so many thousands of idols are coming, it creates certain problems. But the solution doesn't lie in force. It lies in love. And already, I think we have been, earlier we used to do Nimajjanam. This year, in my house, I have put a clay idol and put it in the bucket, and that whatever remaining is there, we are using in the plants. So slowly, we have to mold the ideas, attitudes, and everything is not by force. The moment you apply force, there will be a counter reaction. And sitting there and talking is very easy. If you try and come and implement a tax on them, then you will have disastrous consequences in terms of violent attacks. So therefore, it has to be a mix of both. Law coming into picture, attitudes being changed. Now there may not be any requirement because burgeoning population, you cannot take so many idols and you said plaster of Paris, that should not be used. So earlier it was not used. It is used recently. So the solution doesn't lie in brute force and GHMC or HMD are the last people to do that. It is a more law and order problem or attitudinal issue. We have to mold the social attitudes of the people and convince them. And I think in the coming 10 years, there will be a lot of change. With people getting more enlightened, more conscious about environment, hopefully it will come. And definitely there are laws. You cannot pollute lakes. That will take care. So it has to be a mix. Thank you very much. And I thank all the participants to actively participating in this session.